I felt extremely confident going into the Olympics, my second Olympics, having that goal to win and having had all the experience and built all the confidence over the prior 3 years going into that Games, it was a lot easier for me. I felt if I could execute and if my hamstring held up, I was gonna win. So I was confident. And in the first Olympics, I was happy to be there, and the expectations were so different. For me, it was just about going in there and taking the race as almost as a job, opposed to the experience. And I learned that going into my second Olympics. I learned that from my first Olympics. I try to get a flyer. And I always did that in the finals, even the World Championships. And I knew it really annoyed James Carter. So if I could get in his head, that's exactly what I was gonna do. So if I can get the flyer, I could, but if I didn't, I knew it would be a false start and people would have to reset. And I was prepared for that, but most people weren't. But you could see on James's face, he was a bit annoyed, so it worked. And he went out a lot harder than normal, so he didn't have much coming home. So I think it did its job. So I get out very well. I knew I was gonna come up on Kata because he's real tall. But once he gets going, I knew I could settle in on him and just gauge my pace off him. Slowly passing Kata. Watching Benny Brazil go out there, I was a little worried, but not being able to see what was going on inside of me. When I came off the sixth going into seventh, I felt James, so then I was a little worried there because I felt he was a little too close. But I knew I had a lot coming home because I saved some at the beginning, mainly just because of my hamstring. But then coming off 10, I didn't feel anybody. I was clear, and I knew no one in that race could catch me from behind. So it was just a matter of getting to the tape. And then it sinks in, like, you finally accomplished what you've been trying to do for the last 4 years since Sydney, and it was a good moment, just being able to go to the birthplace of the Olympics and win the very first Olympic gold medal for my country. I wasn't shocked, but I was shocked. Like, it was almost, it's like you, I don't know, it's kind of like the kid that asked Santa Claus for a bicycle. And he expects to get his bicycle. But when he actually sees the bicycle in the living room, he's like, oh my God, I got my bike. And it was the same thing. I expected to win, I wanted to win. I would have been extremely disappointed had I not won. So then after winning, it was almost like wow, like you actually won. Like, cause you're supposed to believe in yourself and you're supposed to be confident. So you should go in thinking you're gonna win, but when you actually do it, it's a great feeling. But yeah, I was in shock. This is a special moment because I knew a lot of people in the Dominican Republic were watching, and this was the first time they were gonna be able to hear their national anthem on a global stage. Looks so young. I know this made a lot of people proud back home. Being able to be the first Dominican in Olympic history, you know, a country that loves sport, but is more geared to baseball, I didn't know how they would receive it. And they really started showing me how much they they loved the Olympic Games, but they had no expectation prior to me as far as hopefuls. So then after me winning and seeing the reception when I came home and the people lining the streets and in the highways, and it was overwhelming. Just seeing that the mindset go from we're going to participate to now we're going to win medals, it's a good feeling to know that I was part of that process and giving them that hope and that belief that it's possible. To 08, I was almost not gonna go. And then the Olympic Committee president called me and he said they wanted me, whether I competed or not, to bear the flag of the opening ceremonies. And that was something for me was an extreme honor, and it never crossed my mind to ever be part of that. So I went not thinking I was gonna compete. And after the opening ceremonies, I felt encouraged, and I was like, well, let's give it a try, coach. And then the morning of the prelim, I got the call that my grandmother had passed away. And for me, she was so dear to me, having helped raise me as I was growing up and helped my mother raise me, being so far from all our family in New York when she moved to San Diego. Hearing that news crushed me. I was devastated, and I literally cried the whole day, and I made up my mind I wasn't gonna run. And then I got encouraged to go out and just do it for her. And for me, that was the first time I'd entered a competition not worried about execution, not worried about the result, not worried about anything, just going in and kind of taking that moment with my grandmother, just to share that with her. And I decided like 3 hours before the race that I was gonna go, and I warmed up and I was still kind of fighting back tears. And it was an odd feeling because I'm used to being full of energy and focus and confidence. And there I felt empty, I felt lack of motivation. I just was just a shell of myself, and went through the race, and I don't even know what race pattern I ran. I couldn't feel the buzz of the crowd. It was almost like I was running a practice run and the stadium was empty and it was just me and the 10 hurdles. Then I crossed the line and I thought that was probably gonna be my last race. And I kneeled down and I had my peace with my grandmother because I knew I wasn't gonna be able to have that back home. And I don't know, I walked out the stadium and nobody asked me any questions, and it kind of just disappeared. And I felt I was at one of the lowest moments in my athletic careers. Just feeling that emptiness and that the lack of accomplishment. But I was talked into to continue and try and win one more major championship for my grandmother. And after about a couple months of being just sulking in it and sharing time with my family, I decided why not, and then I went on to try the next World Championships and the next World Championships, and it came up short and came up short, and then it led me to 2012. After every injury and every year that it didn't go well, you know your window of opportunity is slowly closing, and you know that younger guys are coming, and the chances of you continuing and ultimately achieving it is getting slim and slimmer and slimmer. So you have all these factors going against you. It's even the greatest champions, eventually you're just gonna succumb to it and walk away or retire. No one thought I had a chance to get on the podium, let alone win it. Coulson was the favorite. Angel Taylor was the reigning Olympic champion. He was obviously dangerous. I was more focused on almost redemption and just accomplishing it all for my grandmother. I wasn't able to be overwhelmed by the moment, or I wasn't really succumb to the pressures of achieving or not achieving. I was just going out there to do my best for my grandmother and to execute my race plan and hope it was enough. I felt I got out really good. Jehu Gordon went out a lot harder than I anticipated, actually. Having raced him in the semifinal, it took me a lot longer to come up on his hip. But I was confident going into five. I felt I was in good position. I knew he wasn't a great finisher, so I knew I at least had him beat. I felt the race was inside of me, so I couldn't see who was moving, who had broken the stagger, who was ahead of me. So we came off seven. I started feeling, we start all kind of evening up, and I felt Coulson and Taylor. So I knew I was at least in third. And then when we came off eight is when I realized that I had a good chance of winning, because they were not as far ahead as they would have needed to be ahead of me for me not to catch them. I knew, I was like, okay, well, I can win this. Going into from 9 to 10, when I came off 9, going to 10, I knew I had it, and it was just a matter of just clearing that last hurdle, not hitting it, and running to the finish line, because no one was gonna catch me. I would come to tears walking from my car to training, to practice a few times, just thinking about the possibility of actually achieving what was considered impossible, and just knowing how much I wanted that, how much I wanted to accomplish that. I wanted to be the first to do the impossible. Well, for me, I had that picture since 08 with me, and it was pretty much my only picture with my grandmother. I decided for the final to take it, and I was like, you know, I'll pin it under my bib. And then I thought, I was like, this is probably not legal. So oddly enough, through the call room, I'm not nervous at all about the race. I was so distracted about not getting caught with this picture under my bib that I didn't even have a chance to be nervous. I was just like, please don't see it, please don't see it. Because they check you very thoroughly. The road was off for her, so I wanted her there on that ride, not knowing if it was gonna be my last ride or my last Olympics. I wanted her on for that ride if we won. And then it was my opportunity to kind of take her out, share her with the world, and kind of just have our moment, give her a kiss and say we did it. But yeah, I mean, it's a special moment getting on the podium. Yeah, that was.
Gold medalist and Olympic champion representing the Dominican Republic, Félix Sánchez.
Yeah, this is the toughest moment, because this is when it all really settles in. And then it started raining, so that didn't help me at all, because then I was just thinking of my grandmother, and it was almost like she was She was happy and crying tears of joy, so it made it tough to hold back my tears. Only I know how difficult it was to get back on that podium, and how difficult it was to find that belief in myself, even though no one else believed, and especially in a sport where greats like myself, my first few years, those comeback stories just don't happen. With hard work and sacrifice and dedication, even the impossible is possible.